بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد عبدك ورسولك النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع ومن قلب لا يخشع ومن عين لا تدمع ومن نفس لا تشبع اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وَأَنْتَ تَجْعَلُ الْحَزْنَ إِذَا شِئْتَ سَهْلًا. We begin by thanking and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we beseech him to shower Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions and his family and all those who follow his tradition until the end of time with peace, mercy and blessings. We beg Allah to teach us that which benefits us and to allow us to benefit from that which he has taught us and to increase us in beneficial knowledge. And we seek refuge in Allah from information which does not benefit, and from a heart which does not tremble at his remembrance, and from an eye that does not shed tears, and from a nafs that does not find satisfaction. And we affirm that nothing is accomplished except with the help of Allah, and he is the one who is capable of making the most difficult possible. As to what follows, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a very interesting encounter, which is told to us by the companion Anas ibn Malik in this authentic hadith that I will share with you all. روى البخاري ومسلم في صحيحهما عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنهما قال بينما أنا ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خارجين من المسجد فلقينا رجلا عند سدة المسجد فقال يا رسول الله متى الساعة؟ قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أعددت لها ما أعددت لها قال فكأن الرجل استكان ثم قال يا رسول الله ما أعددت لها كبير صلاة ولا صيام ولا صدقة ولكني أحب الله ورسوله قال فأنت مع من أحببت وفي رواية أنس فما فرحنا بعد الإسلام فرحا أشد من قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فإنك مع من أحببت وفي صحيح مسلم عن أنس بن مالك قال فأنا أحب الله ورسوله وأبا بكر وعمر فأرجو أن أكون معهم وإن لم أعمل بأعمالهم. Anas, the companion Anas ibn Malik, narrates in a hadith which is recorded in the books of Bukhari and Muslim and is authentic in the highest of levels. And Anas ibn Malik, by the way, is a companion who was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from a very young age, very early on. His mother, Ar-Rumaysa, she placed him in the service of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was a young boy. And she told him, serve the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and stay in his company for as much as you can and benefit and learn as much as you can. So being in that presence from such a young age afforded him these kinds of experiences and these observations. So Anas says, بينما أنا ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خارجين من المسجد فلقينا رجلا عند سدة المسجد. He says, myself and the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, we are exiting the masjid and we bumped into this man at the door of the masjid. And so the man asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, قال يا رسول الله متى الساعة. He asked the Messenger of Allah, when is the day of judgment? When's it going to take place? Perhaps a question that has come to many of our minds. You know, it's something that we hear about a lot. We hear about the day of judgment, and we hear about heaven and hell and the grave and all of these events of the afterlife. And so the question begs itself, well, when is that going to take place? And so here we have this companion who is thinking the same thing. And he asks the Messenger of Allah. Before we move on to the actual crux of the hadith, this shows you the comfort level that the companions had with the Messenger of Allah. It shows you their eagerness to learn and ask questions and be inquisitive. It shows you what they cared about, that there is attention and there is focus and their thoughts are about the afterlife and about the day of judgment. And it also shows you the accessibility that they had to the Prophet ﷺ to learn and ask and have matters that they are wondering about clarified. Just from this question, we can extrapolate these points of benefit, all of which are very important. And this is something that we should emulate the companions in. You know, one of the scholars, he has a whole work on the questions of the companions. And he actually spoke about different topics of jurisprudence, just focusing, just based on the questions that the companions asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So being inquisitive is something that is praiseworthy. Ibn Abbas was asked, how did you amass all of this knowledge that you have? He said, قلب عقول ولسان سؤول. To have a composed, focused, intellect and heart, and an inquisitive tongue. Always trying to learn more and clarify and understand better. So this is what the companions were doing. But then also look at the nature of their questions. You know, they say there's no such thing as a dumb question. Fine, but there are some that are more intelligent than others. You know, based on what a person prioritizes. So you see that the companions are always asking about matters that are important. So he asked the Prophet ﷺ, when is the day of judgment? Because he's concerned about it. The Prophet ﷺ responded to his question with a question. So remember we said, you know, ask about that which is important. So he asked about a topic which is important. But he is a little bit to the side. The Prophet ﷺ wants to direct his focus. Direct his attention. The Prophet ﷺ said, مَاذَا أَعْدَدْتَ لَهَا. What have you prepared for the day of judgment? So here we have another pause, which is when we're responding to questions, sometimes it is out of intelligence that you position the questioner and allow them to refocus on that which is more important. One of our teachers said, if you always answer a question exactly as it is being asked, then actually that can be sometimes foolish. Sometimes you can actually mislead a person. You know, because oftentimes people ask loaded questions. Or sometimes people ask a question, but really it's a statement with a question mark at the end. Or sometimes people ask a question because they're shopping for an answer. Or sometimes they just want to know what you're all about. You know, and this is especially important when we are dealing with a lot of people in this day and age that have a lot of questions about Islam. A lot of questions about our religion, our way of life. So you have to be able to differentiate between what is a question that you need to answer head on, or you need to be in charge of the conversation and direct the topic to that which is important, to that which matters. A lot of times people come up to us and they ask us questions about Islam, and it's really about the most detailed of minutiae. And it's like, hold on a minute. Let's redirect and focus on something that is really important. Thank you for asking me about my religion. Let's talk about what really matters in Islam. Okay, so we learn from the Prophet ﷺ that we have to maintain that focus. Be in the driver's seat. So the Prophet ﷺ says, مَاذَا أَعْدَدْتَ لَهَا. What have you prepared for the day of judgment? You see, in another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ was approached by the angel Jibreel. And he came in the form of a man. And he asked him, when is the day of judgment? مَتَ السَّاعَةَ. And the Prophet ﷺ, he was the only one that knew that it was Jibreel. The other companions, to them it was a strange man. The Prophet ﷺ responded, everyone's listening, he said that the one who is asking doesn't know, the one who is being asked does not know any better than the one who is asking. Meaning, I don't know when the day of judgment is going to be, and neither do you. And I know you don't know either. مَلْ مَسْؤُولِ عَنْهَا بِأَعْلَمَ مِنَ السَّائِلِ. The day of judgment, when it will take place, this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reserved to His knowledge exclusively. There is no creation. Not even the angel Jibreel. There is no creation. There is no one other than Allah that knows when the day of judgment will take place. Okay, so the next time you come across one of these, estimates, or deductions that the end of the universe will take place on such and such day, you know, you could just push that aside and say, you know, I'm not interested in that. Because this is something that this knowledge that is reserved with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even the Messenger of Allah didn't know about it. Even the Messenger of Allah did not know about it. So he says, what have you prepared for the Day of Judgment? Meaning, implying that I don't know when the Day of Judgment is, and neither do you, and you know what, we're not gonna know. We'll know when it happens. But what we do know is what we can prepare. How we can be ready for when that time comes. Because we're not debating about whether it's coming or not. That is not up for debate. That is something that is concrete and conclusive. But what we should be focusing on is what we can do to prepare. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Ihris ala ma yanfa'uk." Focus your attention and your energy on that which is beneficial to you. It's of no benefit for us to sit down and spend so much time and energy making all of these calculations and deductions and estimations about when the Day of Judgment is. That is of no benefit. What is of benefit is to make sure that when that time comes, that I will be in the best possible position. So the Prophet ﷺ said, مَا أَعْدَدْتَ لَهَا, what have you prepared for it? So the man paused for a minute. He was kind of, you know, taken aback by that question. Because he expected, you know, an answer. When is the Day of Judgment? You ask a question like that, you're expecting a specific answer. The Prophet says, what have you prepared for it? He's like, whoa. So the man paused for a second. And he was thinking, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, ما أعددت لها كبير صلاة ولا صيام ولا صدقة. And as you hear this companion respond, I want you to think if you have anything in common, if we have anything in common with this companion. He says, you know what, O Messenger of Allah, you know, I gotta be honest with you, I haven't prepared a great deal of salat, of prayer, or fasting, or charity. You know, there are some people, mashallah, getting up in the night, so much devotion. I'm not one of those guys. There are some people, so much fasting. I'm not one of those guys either. There are some people, mashallah, just so much charity, such generosity. You know, I'm not really one of those either. I'm just the average Joe here. You know? ما أعددت لها كبير صلاة ولا صيام ولا صدقة. ولكني, he says, but, you know, there is one thing that I can say with full confidence. ولكني أحب الله ورسوله. I can say with full confidence that I love Allah and His Messenger. That I can say for sure. And so the Prophet ﷺ responded, and he said, فَأَنْتَ مَعَ مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ. You will be with those that you love. In the afterlife, you will be with those, you will be in the company of those that you truly love. So that's really special. Imagine how that companion felt. And we can get an idea how the Sahaba felt, because the narrator of the hadith, Anas, what does he say? He says, in the narration of Sahih Muslim, Anas says, فَمَا فَرِحْنَا بَعْدَ الْإِسْلَامِ فَرَحًا أَشَدَّ مِنْ قَوْلِ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَإِنَّكَ مَعَ مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ. Anas says, from the day we became Muslim, from the day we learnt what Islam is, nothing has been more happy to us than this statement of the Messenger, you will be with those whom you love. You know? Finding out about Islam, accepting Islam, that's the happiest thing that we have in our lives. After that, nothing has made us more happy than this statement of the Prophet ﷺ, you will be with those whom you love. That really excited Anas ibn Malik and the companions. In another narration, also in Sahih Muslim, Anas ibn Malik, the narrator, he responds and he says, then definitely I love Allah. And I love His Messenger, and I love Abu Bakr and Umar, these luminaries of the companions, his seniors. And he says, فَأَرْجُوا أَنْ أَكُونَ مَعَهُمْ. I am so hopeful, and I am seeking that I will be with them, in their company and in their presence. Even though, وَإِنْ لَمْ أَعْمَلْ بِأَعْمَالِهِمْ. Even though I have not accomplished the same deeds that they have accomplished.
I know that they're better than me, but I love them. And so because of this sincere love, I am hopeful that Allah will unite me with them in the Akhirah. That's really special. And that's why Ibn al-Qayyim, the scholar Ibn al-Qayyim, he spent a great deal of his famous book, you know, he has authored dozens of books, one of them which is the most famous, he devoted an entire section to loving Allah. But he took it a step further, and he mentioned al-asbab al-ashara. He mentioned 10 means, 10 ways by which tajlibu mahabbatillah, by which draw to the person, to the lover, the love of Allah. Because as the scholar said, it is one thing for a person to proclaim that they love Allah, but how can a person ensure that Allah, that their creator, loves them? That's really taking that goal and that emotion to the next level. So he says, السبب الأول قراءة القرآن بتدبر والتفهم لمعانيه وما أريد به. So he says the first reason, the first means by which to attain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is recitation of the Qur'an with tadabbur, with pondering and with reflection. Recitation of Qur'an with pondering and with reflection. This word tadabbur, what does it mean and what does it refer to? What are the implications of this term? Because he did not simply say reciting Qur'an just like that. Recitation of Qur'an in of itself is an act of worship. And the recitation of Qur'an in and of itself is a means of drawing nearer to Allah. And it's one of the best forms of dhikr, of remembrance. And it's a form of cleansing and of purification. But it is step one. Now the problem is that the best of us in this ummah are stuck on step one. Step one is the recitation of the Qur'an. And step two is understanding the meanings. And step three is having a reaction or a response or an interaction rather. Pondering and being able to reflect. And that's the level at which you're able to extract meanings and benefits and reflections. So the recitation of Qur'an alone is an act of worship. Did I ever tell you guys the story? I know I did. One of my favorite stories. Did I tell you guys the story of the young boy and his grandfather? Who heard it before? Somebody here has got to hear it. You heard it? Yeah? So you know what I'm talking about. Okay. Pretend to be amazed, please. So they said there was a young boy with, I'll give you guys the abridged version, okay? They say there was a young kid with his grandfather, and grandpa gave the kid a bucket with holes at the bottom, and he told him, go down to the stream and fetch some water. And the boy looked at his grandfather like, we need to take you to, you know, a psychiatrist. And he was like, go down and get me some water in this bucket. Get. So the boy, he's like, okay, fine. So he goes down, tries to fill up the bucket, and what do you think happened? Well, gravity happened. And there was no water, it all seeped through the holes at the bottom of the bucket. So he comes back and he's like, yeah, it's not gonna work. He said, go back, do it again. He's like, seriously, go back. So he goes, tries to, you know, fill it up again, it won't work. Oh, I left out a really important detail. See, when you tell a story too many times, sometimes you forget important details. So I've told the story too many times. Basically, this bucket was from the fireplace. You know, it was like a, where they collect like the coal or, you know, wood or whatever they're burning. So it has holes at the bottom. So basically, it was really dirty. So, you know, he go to a second time, go back, fill up the bucket. He's like, I can't do it. He's like, go back again. You know, time after time. So then the boy is like, okay, I need to get some amount of water in here so I can impress this guy and get him to stop making me run up and down this hill. So he, you know, he tries to angle it, do like this, like that, whatever he can do. You know, eventually the best he can do is just a few drops. And then, you know, eventually he tells Grandpa, that's it. You know, he drops the bucket. He's like, I don't know what you're getting at here, but I can't do it. Please stop asking me to run up and down this hill. I'm tired. And so Grandpa's like, I know you can't fill it up. He's like, really? He's like, yeah, but I want you to look at that bucket. So he looks at it and he says, okay. He says, what do you notice different about it? He says, nothing. It's the same old bucket with the same old holes. The only difference is because you made me run up and down all this time with all the moving of water, it's actually clean now. He's like, aha, there you go. So he told him, oh my young son, this is the example of you reading Quran. You still have a lot to learn. You may have difficulty understanding everything that you are reciting, but that will come with time. But even just the recitation, just the passage and the movement of the words of the Quran is a means of cleansing your heart, just like the movement of the water has cleansed this bucket of the soot and the dirt that had piled up on it. You were not able to retain any of the water, but you were still able to clean. And that is the effect. So Allah told us in the Quran that the Quran is shifa, that it's a cure. Allah told us in the Quran that it is rahmah, it is a mercy, that it is nur, that it is light. So all of these are manifestations of the Quran. So a lot of us, you know, when we talk about reading the Quran with reflection and pondering, we're like, look, I don't know Arabic. You know, what do you want me to do? And so we say, you know, لا تعجز, don't give up. Don't focus only on, you know, what you can't attain now. But continue reading, continue struggling. Even just the recitation with struggling is a means of a lot of reward. The Prophet ﷺ said, the one who is reading, وَهُوَ عَلَيْهِ شَاقْ وَيَتَتَعْتَعُ فِيهِ, the one who the reading is difficult, he's still learning the letters, the sounds, is some struggle there. The Prophet said, فَلَهُ أَجْرًا, this person has double reward. So even just going through that struggle and that process is a means of attaining reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that's step one. Then the next step is actually understanding the meanings. So for many of us, that would begin with something as simple as opening up a translation and just getting a general overview of the translation, of the meanings of the Quran. What are these words referring to? You know, the general context. That's at the most basic level. You know, when they talk about the subject of tafsir, of the meanings of the Quran, that's like the most basic level, just cracking open a translation. And by the way, there's a lot of different translations out there, some of them a bit more fluid than others, because you have to understand a lot of people that translated the Quran many, many decades ago, they were very eloquent, not only in Arabic, but also in English as well. And so they translated in the highest form of eloquence. But there's a lot of more recent translations that are a bit less archaic in nature, if you will. A little bit less Shakespearean. So maybe pull out some of those if you're having trouble. So that's at the basic level. And then when we talk about tafsir of the Quran, what we are aiming to answer, the question that we are aiming to answer is what? You know, the study of the subject of tafsir tells us what. What is Allah saying here? So we go over vocabulary terms. What do these words mean? What's the linguistic origin of this word? How is it used in the Arabic language? How did the ancient Arabs use these words? Because the Quran was revealed in the language of Arabic. We also go over other verses in the Quran that clarify those verses. So we want to understand when Allah in Surah Al-Fatiha says, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. In Surah Al-Fatiha, every single day we are repeating this supplication to God, grant us, guide us to the straight path, the path of those upon whom you have bestowed your blessings. So we look at another passage in the Quran where Allah tells us who are those people and tells us the categories of those people. So sometimes the Quran expands upon itself in different places. We look at narrations of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many times the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will comment on a specific verse and say, this means X, Y, and Z, or this verse is referring to such and such. We look at statements of the companions. who were with the Prophet ﷺ at the time of revelation. And we see those that witnessed revelation, and they were there and they were present when it took place, what exactly they learned or what they exactly understood from those verses. Also very important is context. For many of the verses, we have context. We know exactly what event took place that led to the revelation of this verse. Now, every single verse has a more broad application, but for many of the verses, there is a specific event that that this verse was a response to, that this verse was revealed because of that event taking place. And we have many examples of that. So we look at all of these things, and this helps us answer the question, what is Allah saying in this verse? But that's only step two. So once you have done step one and step two, then you can move on to step three, which is actually responding and reflecting. Now you have an arsenal of information, you have context, you have background, you know what the words are referring to exactly. Now you can start asking the question, why? Now you can start asking the question, what about me? And that really is the objective of reading the Quran. So for those of us that are getting stuck at step one and step two, we haven't yet fulfilled the objective of reading the Quran. We have only done the prerequisites, if you will. What is the proof for that? The proof for that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. Allah said in the Quran that we have revealed a blessed book so that they would do tadabbur, so that they would ponder and reflect on a deeper level upon its meanings. So the recitation of Quran is mandatory and it's necessary for our spiritual health and for our connection with Allah. Understanding what Allah is saying is absolutely mandatory. But all of those are steps to get to the main objective, which is to be able to interact with the Quran and be able to have introspective thoughts and reflections and see how this affects me. How can we turn this experience of recitation into a personal experience that is directly related to me in my life? And so that's why Ibn al-Qayyim classified this as the first means of jalb, the word he uses, of magnetizing towards yourself, guaranteeing for yourself the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قِرَاءَةُ الْقُرْآنِ بِالتَّدَبُّرِ. Imam An-Nawawi says something beautiful. He says, أَوَّلُ مَا يَجِّبُ عَلَى الْقَارِئِ أَنْ يَسْتَحْضِرَ فِي نَفْسِهِ أَنَّهُ يُنَاجِ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى. The scholar Imam An-Nawawi says, when a person sits down to recite Quran, the first thing that they should realize and the mindset that they should be in is that they are having an intimate conversation with Allah the Most High. They are having an intimate conversation with their Creator. If a person is not in that mindset, that will inhibit their ability to interact on a deeper level. And that is why we see another hadith of one of the companions who was able to secure for himself the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How? Let us look at this hadith. There was the companion who used to love to repeat Surah Al-Ikhlas. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ صَمَدٌ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. He used to love to repeat it over and over and over again. And when he was asked why, he said, because this chapter of the Qur'an describes my Lord. And I love my Lord and Creator. And so the Prophet ﷺ, as a response to that, the man said, لِأَنَّهَا صِفَةُ الرَّحْمَنُ وَنَا أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَقْرَأَهَا. He said, this chapter contains a description of the Most Merciful, of my Lord, the Most Merciful, and I love to read that description. The Prophet ﷺ said, أَخْبِرُوهُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبَّهُ. It's narrated in Bukhari. The Prophet said, inform him. If that is really in fact his reasoning, then inform him that Allah loves him. So this is someone that by the affirmation of the Prophet ﷺ, this is someone that Allah loves. And how did he attain that love? Because he read this small chapter of the Qur'an over and over again, but he read it with emotion, with presence of mind and heart, with reflection. He understood that this is something describing Allah. And he loved to read that description of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Dharr, the companion, narrated النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قام ليلة بآية يرددها إن تعذبهم فإنهم عبادك وإن تغفر لهم فإنك أنت العزيز الحكيم. Abu Dharr narrates that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم stood in prayer the entire night repeating one verse over and over again. And that was the verse from Surah Al-Ma'idah. Surah Al-Ma'idah is chapter number 5, verse number 118. Where this comes at the end of Surah Al-Ma'idah. This is a conversation between Isa, Jesus, and Allah on the Day of Judgment. When Isa says, إِن تُعَذِّبْهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ. If you choose to punish these people, then they are your servants. But if you choose to forgive them, then you are the most mighty, the most wise. You know, really powerful verse, exclaiming and proclaiming the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His authority, and how much we are in need of Allah, and how much we are at the mercy of our Creator. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood the entire night repeating this verse. So the scholars, they said one of the ways of being able to interact with certain verses of the Qur'an is possibly repeating them over and over again. Sometimes you need repetition. Sometimes it's not just about reading an explanation. You may read the explanation. You may understand all of the words. But you have to keep repeating it over and over and over again before it clicks. Or before you are able to have a reflection or a reaction that actually penetrates your heart. And I remember one time in Medina, when I had to write this research paper, and so I asked one of my teachers, and I said, you know, so can you give me some guidelines? Where can I get the best resources? You know, I thought he'd give me a list of books or a list of all these things, which he did. He mentioned a few titles, but then the first thing he said, you need to go and sit somewhere alone with no distraction and read this section that you are supposed to write about. The section of the Qur'an, read it 15 or 20 times. And if that's not enough, then do it some more. And maybe do it, you know, several days. You know, with pauses in between. And he said, you know, with each new sitting and with each new reading, you will notice some things that you didn't notice before. This is one of the miracles of the Qur'an. One of the miracles of the Qur'an is that the more you repeat it and the more you recite it and the more you read it, you start noticing things, even if it's something you already memorized. But you will notice certain things that you didn't notice before. Because you're talking not about any average piece of literature here. You're not talking about, you know, the quotes or the words of a human being like you and me. Our words are limited in nature. And even the words of a human being, by the way. You know, a prolific author, for example, someone who is a very eloquent author, man, sometimes you can read their books multiple times. You know, there were several story books. You know, if any of you have children that love to read, you know, enticing story books, sometimes they read the same book over and over again. And you're like, man, aren't you tired with the story? It's kind of getting boring now. But they're enjoying it. You know, there's sometimes you read something over and over again. You've already read it before, but you enjoy reading it again. That's with just a prolific author, a human being whose intellect is limited and whose capabilities are minimal. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of the intellect, and He is the one that taught Adam al-asma'a kullaha, all the words, and so he is not bound by those limitations. And so naturally, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will carry more meaning, even in just a few words. But the meanings will be, you know, endless. And so multiple readings sometimes yield or allow you to observe multiple different observations or different things that you can extrapolate. So if there is a section of Qur'an that you really want to recite, and you want to reflect upon, read it over and over again. This is a practical tip. This is a pro tip. Read it over and over again. I'm not a pro. I'm saying what the pros say, what the Prophet ﷺ did.
وقام تميم الداري رضي الله عنه بآية وهي قوله تعالى أم حسب الذين اجترحوا السيئات أن نجعلهم كالذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات سواء محياهم ومماتهم ساء ما يحكمون.
Tamim al-Dari, one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he also had the same experience. He stood the entire night repeating this verse from Surah Al-Jathiyah, a verse in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala basically says, he asks a rhetorical question, do you consider people that are continuously falling into poor choices and sins and acts of disobedience of Allah, do you really think that you can equate them with those that believe and do righteous deeds? You know, they are not the same. They are not equal or equivalent or on the same level. So this is, there is profound meanings in these verses and in these parables that Allah gives and in these rhetorical questions. Also, the stories in the Qur'an. قصص القرآن. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave so many stories in the Qur'an. And these are really a good training ground and a good way for us to practice interacting. Because there is not really any major, difficult theological meanings or jurisprudential or legal prerequisites that we need to be familiar with before interacting. Some verses of the Quran are a bit, they require certain prerequisites to have a deeper understanding of them. But the majority of the Quran is, as the scholar said, muhkam, is clear and explicit. And there are some other verses that have some ambiguity that require more explanation. But the majority of the Qur'an is very clear and explicit and can be understood and taken at face value. Even though there can be more depth of meaning when you look at it in context. But the stories of the Qur'an are really a great place to begin. Because we're not talking about any major theological issues or any major legal issues. You know, the Qur'an has theology, creed, beliefs in Allah. There is rulings, do's and don'ts. There is mention of what happened in the past. There is mention of what is to come in the future. There is wa'd and wa'id. There is warnings and glad tidings. All of these are different themes of the Qur'an. The stories of Qur'an are one of the best places for someone who wants to develop the skill of tadabbur and the ability and strengthen the muscle of reflecting upon the Qur'an. This is a good place to begin. Because it's a story. Everybody loves hearing and listening and reading stories. So you have the stories of the Anbiya, of the prophets and messengers. Musa alayhi salam, his story is repeated the most in the Qur'an, more than 60 times. You have the story of Ibrahim. You have the story of Adam, the story of Nuh, the story of Isa, all mentioned dozens of times throughout the Qur'an. And there's a lot of meaning that can be extrapolated. You also have mention of the tests and the difficulties that these messengers endured. Ayyub and Zakariya and Yunus, etc. Maryam, the mother of Isa, the mother of Musa, the sister of Musa. Qarun, you have individuals that are also blameworthy individuals. They did not heed reminders and remembrance, and they were oppressive. Fir'aun. All of these are individuals that are mentioned in the Qur'an, and their stories are mentioned in detail and at great length so that we can reflect, and so that we can ponder, and extract meanings that affect us personally in our lives. So a good place to begin is the stories of the Qur'an, Qisas al-Qur'an. طيب, the next means is التقرب إلى الله بالنوافل بعد الفرائض فإنها موصلة إلى درجة المحبوب بعد المحبة. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في الحديث القدسي عن رب العزة سبحانه وتعالى من عادى لي وليا فقد آذنته بالحرب وما تقرب إلي عبدي بشيء أحب إلي مما افترضته عليه ولا يزال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه فإذا أحببته كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به وبصره الذي يبصر به ويده التي يبطش بها ورجله التي يمشي بها ولئن سألني لأعطينه ولئن استعاذني لأعيذنه رواه البخاري. So in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is a hadith Qudsi. Hadith Qudsi means that it is a statement of Allah, but it is coming on the tongue of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it is not a verse of Quran. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that Allah said, "Man 'ada li waliyan faqad adhantuhu bil harb." Whoever treats one of my allies with animosity, then I have announced a declaration of war against this person. This is Allah saying that. That whoever harms or oppresses or treats any awliya of Allah, the people that are allies of Allah, the people that are obedient and pious in their devotion to Allah, whoever shows animosity towards them, Allah says, I declare war against those people. Just like, you know, in human relations or in government relations, if someone is an ally of someone and somebody else comes and shows animosity towards them, essentially it's like you've declared war against their allies. Allah says the same thing. I have certain allies and people that are under my protection, and whoever shows animosity towards them, then they are essentially declaring war against me. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّ افْتَرَضْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ. That my servant does not seek to come close to me with anything more beloved to me than that which I have made obligatory upon them. Let's dissect that a bit. Allah is basically saying, the most beloved deeds to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most high, most majestic, are those deeds that He has made obligatory. So if a person wants to be loved by Allah, they should make sure that they fulfill those actions that are obligatory. مِمَّ افْتَرَضْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ, that which Allah has made فَرِيضًا or fard or obligatory. But then there is a step after that. وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ. Then Allah says, but once my servant fulfills those mandatory and obligatory actions, and they still want more closeness, they still want more love. You know, something that is good, something that is valuable, you always want more of it. You know, if you value something, you won't get tired. You won't want to stop. You know, so people that love wealth, for example, nobody ever makes $1 million and says, yeah, that's good, I'm okay there, you know. We'll just, you know, nobody does that. People that love or they want financial success that badly, and they work so hard, and they make $1 million, they want the next million. That's how it works. So that can be both praiseworthy and it can be blameworthy as well. It's praiseworthy if it is within the parameters of what is pleasing to Allah. And it's blameworthy when a person prefers what they love over what is pleasing to Allah. Very simple equation. Anyways, so a person loves Allah and they love doing these actions that are pleasing to Him. So they do those obligatory actions, but they want more. They want more love. So they begin to do nawafil, voluntary acts of worship. And just the nature of voluntary acts is that it's emanating from a place of devotion and from a place of love. You know, you don't volunteer for something unless it's something that you care about. Because the nature of volunteering is you're going above and beyond. You're going above and beyond what you are required and what's being asked of you. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made certain things obligatory. So here, you know, when we talk about obligatory actions, you know, there are people that love Allah and they fulfill obligatory actions, but then there are people that have a little bit of deficiency in love, but they're like, ah, I got to, so let me do it, you know? And subhanAllah, I think a lot of us, you know, maybe the best of us are at that level where we're like, you know, why are you doing your five times, you know, salat? Why are you doing all of these obligatory actions? Because they're obligatory, because I have to, you know? Okay, fine. A better response would be because a person is doing it from a place of love. In any case, both of these individuals are fulfilling their obligations, but the one who wants more love of Allah, and the one who has more love of Allah, they will start to do voluntary acts of worship. So you'll find them fasting outside of Ramadan. And you're like, why are you fasting? Only Ramadan is obligatory. They're like, you know what? I know that this is an act of worship that is beloved to Allah. You find them being so generous, and it's like, didn't you pay your zakah? They're like, yeah, I did my obligatory zakah. It's like, but they want more. You know, you see them helping others. You see them being kind and generous above and beyond what is required. So these are the nawafil, the voluntary deeds. So Allah says that my servant continues wanting to seek closeness and wanting to be loved, that they start doing voluntary. They start doing voluntary acts of worship, and then there is a result to that. What is the result? Hatta uhibba. So then Allah says, you know what? When they do that, they go above and beyond. Allah says, then I love that servant. But there's a result to that as well. So then what happens? Allah says, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ كُنْتُ سَمْعُهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ. Allah says, when I love that servant, I will be their hearing that they hear with. وَبَصَرَهُ الَّذِي يُبْصِرُ بِهِ. And the vision by which they see with. وَيَدَهُ الَّتِي يَبْطِشُ بِهَا. And the hand by which they strike with. وَرِجْلَهُ الَّتِي يَمْشِي بِهَا. And the feet by which they walk with. وَلَئِن سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّهُ. And when they ask of me something, I give it to them. وَلَئِنِ اسْتَعَاذَنِي لَأُعِيذَنَّهُ. And when they seek my protection, they seek my protection from something, I will protect them from it. So that is the result that Allah tells us of Him loving His servants. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects a person's senses, their hearing and their vision and their touch, their hands and their feet, where they are going, what they are able to accomplish with their limbs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses and protects these senses. And it is mentioned of the our elders, something that was passed down. It is mentioned of the elders and of the seniors that they were asked that you have reached such a high age and yet your faculties are all intact. You know, your abilities, your senses are all functioning at a high level. How, you know, what's the trick? You know, when you scour the internet, all these things pop up and say, you know, do these five healthy habits, you'll live longer, you'll be able to have all of these, you know, you'll be running marathons at age 70 and all these things. And we're like, wow, you know, let me do that, right? So it was asked of the elders that how are you able to preserve these faculties? They said, حَفِظْنَاهَا فِي الصِّغَرْ. They said, we protected and we preserved these faculties at a young age, so Allah protected and preserved them for us, fil kibar, at an elderly age. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when a person goes above and beyond and does these voluntary acts of worship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises to protect and preserve and bless these senses and these faculties and these abilities. So the scholars, they said that people that worship Allah are on different categories. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala outlined for us in Surah Fatir. ثم أورثنا الكتاب الذين اصطفينا من عبادنا فمنهم ظالم لنفسه ومنهم سابق ومنهم سابق بالخيرات بإذن. What's before that? مقتصد. What's the verse? ثم أورثنا الكتاب الذين اصطفينا من عبادنا فمنهم ظالم لنفسه ومنهم مقتصد ومنهم سابق بالخيرات بإذن الله. In Surah Fatir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala outlines categories of people and He places them on three levels. And so He says that there are those who are ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ, oppressing themselves. وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدْ. And there are those who are teeter-tottering, you know, just maintaining a kind of a balance of good and bad, back and forth. وَمِنْهُمْ سَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. And then there are those, there is that category where they are hastening and they are racing to do good deeds. The scholars have a lot of commentary on this verse. Some of them said this refers to recitation of Quran specifically, that there are those who don't recite Quran or don't recite it enough. And there are those who their interaction with the Quran is, you know, up and down. And then there are those who are constantly with the Quran and living with the Quran. And other scholars said this is am, this is general, with any a good deed, with any ibadah, that there are those who are deficient. There is some deficiency. You know, they're doing their fara'id, they're doing their obligatory acts, but there's some gaps, some holes there. There's a lot of room for improvement. And then there are those who, You know, sometimes they're doing the good, and then sometimes they, you know, they're kind of maintaining that back and forth balance. And then there are those who are always hastening and always trying to do more and do better and always focused about what is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make us amongst them. So they said those that are loving of Allah are also on different levels.
المحب لله مؤد للفرائض لفرائض الله وقاف عند حدوده.
They said, you know, the first level is the one who does what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands and does not do what He forbids. They're like on the line, you know? He says, you know, sign on the dotted line, they're on the dotted line exactly, right? And there is another level,
المحبوب من الله متقرب إلى الله بعد الفرائض بالنوافل. وهذا مقصود ابن القيم رحمه الله بقوله فإنها موصلة إلى درجة المحبوبية بعد المحبة.
And then other level is those that not just they are doing what Allah commands and staying away from what He forbids, yes, granted, but then they volunteer and they increase in doing more and trying to increase in their love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the category that Ibn al-Qayyim was referring to in this list. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in this hadith Qudsi, going above and beyond. We will stop at these two, and we will continue, inshallah, in our next gathering. The next one, the third one, is دوام ذكره على كل حال باللسان والقلب والعمل والحال فنصيبه من المحبة على قدر نصيبه من الذكر. The third means of drawing and securing the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is constant and consistent dhikr and remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Ibn al-Qayyim says, in every situation, في كل حال, and he says, باللسان وبالقلب وبالأعمال, dhikr of Allah with the tongue and with the heart and with the actions and with the state of being. We will go into detail about what he is referring to. What is dhikr with the tongue, which is probably what many of us think of when we hear the word dhikr. But then what is remembrance of Allah with the heart and with actions and state of being? We will expand upon that more, inshallah ta'ala. The list is 10. 10 means of drawing and securing, guaranteeing the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who love Him, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those whom He loves. Allahumma inna nas'aluka hubbak wa hubba man yuhibbuk wa hubba amalin yuqarribuna ila hubbika ya kareem. We ask Allah for His love and for the love of those whom He loves and for the love of actions which draw us nearer to Him. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه لا تجعل الأمر ملتبسا علينا فنضل. Oh Allah, we beg You to show us truth clearly as truth and allow us to follow it. And we beg You to show us falsehood clearly as falsehood and allow us to stay away from it. And we beg You to protect us from confusion that would lead us astray. ربنا آتي نفوسنا تقواها وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. O our Lord and Master and Creator, we beg You to grant our hearts piety and consciousness and awareness of You. And You are the one who is most capable of purifying our hearts. You are the Master and Protector of our hearts and our souls. رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. We beg You, O Allah, for the best in this life and the best in the hereafter. And we beg You to protect us from the torment of the hellfire. We beg You, O Allah, as you have gathered us here, to gather us with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the highest levels of Jannat al-Firdaus. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والله أعلم والسلام عليكم. Any questions or comments? Yes. Yes. Musa.
So after a month or so, a few months, Musa al-Islam will find out that whatever Allah has granted him, so he should be
So because he was generous and sharing, Allah multiplied and allowed him to accomplish more with his sustenance. Allahu A'lam. I don't know. Sounds nice, but I don't know what the narration for that is. Jazakallah khair. We'll look into it, inshallah. Any other questions? Yes. Oh. That is almost an impossible question to answer. Almost. And the reason why is because there are literally hundreds of books of tafsir. Literally hundreds. So every tafsir has a different flavor. And different scholars, the Quran is so amazing, there is no scholar or there's no human being that can explain the Quran with such magnificence that it basically is sufficient. There are some books of tafsir that will give you insight into the language, the lugha, that others do not have. There are some that will give you narrations, athar, riwayat, different narrations that others do not have. There are some that will delve into the fiqh, into the law and the jurisprudence that other books do not have. So to really get the full picture, you have to study a variety. But a lot of scholars, what they have done to try and help, because this is a very common question, kind of set a little bit of a kind of steps to follow. And so the first thing is basically getting al-ma'na al-ijmali, or the general meaning of the verses, and understanding the mufradat, the vocabulary words. And so to do this, there are really a lot of small books of tafsir that have some very light commentary along the margins, and these are very beneficial. For example, there is one that was recently published in the last few years. It's called Al-Mukhtasar fi al-Tafsir. Al-Mukhtasar fi al-Tafsir. This was published by a group of scholars, a panel, a contemporary, and they placed at the beginning of every single surah, they have maqasid al-surah, the main objectives of this chapter. And then there is on the margin the general meanings of these verses, and then at the bottom there is fawaid. There are general points of benefit from that page. And they do this for every single page. This is called Al-Mukhtasar fi al-Tafsir, abridged tafsir. It was published by a publishing organization called Markaz al-Tafsir. Markaz al-Tafsir, لدراسات القرآنية. You can find it, you know, if not in print form, it is on PDF, easily accessible. There's also the Quran Printing Complex in Medina. They published a similar project way before them, many, many years ago. They have the Quran, and then there is light, you know, footnotes, if you will, or light commentary on the margins. So that's very good because that's something easily accessible. Yani a person, for example, if they read 5 pages of Quran a day, they can, along with those 5 pages, they can get a general meaning of those 5 pages at the same time. It's something very good to have, especially in Ramadan. Then if you want to get into some easier, some full-on books of tafsir, some of our teachers used to recommend Tafsir al-Baghawi. That is not a very difficult one to go through. Tafsir al-Sa'di, the scholar Abdurrahman ibn al-Sa'di, rahimahullah. There are other contemporary scholars like Sheikh Muhammad Karayim Rajih, hafidhahullah. He's still alive. He has a very light commentary. Sheikh Muhammad Ali Sabuni, hafidhahullah, is still alive. You know, Syrian scholars, may Allah bless them, they have some very or easier, tafsir books to read, like Safwat al-Tafasir, and these are very nice. Sheikh Abu Bakr al-Jazairi, hafidhullah, he has Aysar al-Tafasir, which is also relatively abridged and easy to read. So these are good for a beginner. And then, after that level, oh, Bahrun la sahila lah, that's an ocean that has no shores. يعني, there is a plethora of tafasir. Fi dhilal al-Qur'an is beautiful. I say it Qutb. Ibn Ashur, Sheikh Muhammad al-Tahir ibn Ashur, al-Tahrir wa al-Tanwir is a masterpiece in tafsir. And then, of course, you have Ummahat al-Kutub, the old, you know, the they call them the mothers of the libraries, like Tafsir al-Tabari, Tafsir al-Qurtubi, Tafsir ibn Kathir. I mean, these are some that you really cannot do without if you want to have a proper study of tafsir. But again, it has to be tadarruj. There has to be step by step. If a person is not familiar with the general meanings of the verses and they go jump into the book of Tafsir al-Tabari, they'll be lost before they finish the first page. They'll be lost. They'll be like, huh? What's going on here? You know, a person, you know, doesn't even have a grasp on the vocabulary words and they try to jump into a Tahrir wa Tanweer of Ibn Ashur, they're going to be like, you know, is this Chinese or what's going on here? So there has to be step by step process. Wabillahi tawfiq. May Allah grant us success. Any other questions? Okay. Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.